Well, hello everyone. I'm so glad you can join me once again. We're going to get into the Word of God, and I know as you listen for the voice of the Holy Spirit, you're going to experience much wisdom from our Father God as you tune in to His sweet, loving voice. So why don't we go ahead, let's start off with a word of prayer. Let's come before our Father in heaven. Let's pray. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for this time as we come with our minds and hearts fully submitted to you. I pray, Father, as you speak forth your wisdom upon us, Lord. We're going to choose to live according to your words. We're going to choose to live according to your ways. So, Lord God, we place this time fully into your hands right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray all these things. We all say, Amen. Praise God, praise God. Well, today the title of my sermon is Worshiping God When Your Heart Is Sighing. You know, I gotta tell you, just the other day, I was getting ready for a personal time of praise and worship unto the Lord, and this was during the morning. And as I was about to read my devotional reading online, I was sidetracked by all the headline news that were on Yahoo. Suddenly, I was drawn to all the bad news. And after being swamped into them for almost like 20, 25 minutes, I let out a big sigh, like, and it so happened, John Lee was passing by and she asked me, "What's wrong, Ben?" I answered her, "So much bad news." She then says to me, "So stop already." You know, I was so much buried in the bad news that I had forgotten about the time of devotion I was going to have with the Lord. And there may be times in our lives when it is hard for us to jump right into the singing and praising unto God. When we all feel like we need to sigh and we just keep on sighing. You know, there's this Christian writer, his name is Sean Hipps, and he had written an intriguing article in Leadership Magazine that was called "Praise That Is Immature." And he suggests that when we sing only happy songs, it becomes a kind of pep rally to inspire excitement about who God is. While that may all seem to be good, he says we can't forget to also use grief in our worship, even though it is an unpleasant emotion. And he states that authenticity and integrity in worship means expressing both lament, which is grief, and praise. And each element complements the other. I gotta tell you, I remember a time when I was a young Christian in my 20s and I had just come home from college from the mainland. I'd experienced some difficulties with my job and I was also struggling with some sins that were in my life. You know, I remember when I talked to my brother and another pastor about my struggles, I told them, when I pray, it feels like my prayers were bouncing off the ceiling as if they weren't getting to God. And when I lifted my hands to praise God, I felt like I wasn't worthy. It seems like my arms would slowly come back down every time I would raise them up. And, in a nutshell, they told me that the first step to give God true worship, you must really feel bad about your sins. And what do you do afterwards? You get it right with Him. You repent of your sins. You make it right with Him so that you can experience the fullness of His presence. And when things started to get really worse in my life, I cried out to God in repentance for my sins. I gotta tell you, brothers and sisters, it's true. During the next Sunday service worship, it seemed as if with a mournful heart, I was able to lift my hands higher in worship. But when I did, I gotta tell you, I just couldn't hold back the tears also. It was as if my heart and my hands and the tear ducts in my eyes were all connected. But the most important thing I learned was that if I were to keep on sighing and feeling sorry for myself, it only gets worse. It seems like I would only get farther and farther away from the Lord. Let's look at what the psalmist says when his people are captured by the Babylonians. Let's look at Psalm 137 verses 1 to 6. And this is the Message version. It says here, "Alongside Babylon's rivers, we sat on the banks. We cried and we cried, remembering the good old days in Zion. Alongside the quaking aspens, we stacked our unplayed harps." And that's where our captors demanded songs, sarcastic and mocking. "Sing us a happy Zion song." And they would say, "Oh, how could we ever sing God's song in this wasteland? If I ever forget you, Jerusalem, let my fingers wither and fall off like leaves. Let my tongue swell and turn black if I fail to remember you. If I fail, O dear Jerusalem, to honor you as my greatest." I gotta tell you, for some reason, we may believe that when things have gone sour in our lives, it will become impossible to give God praise in our lives. And I gotta tell you, brothers and sisters, that is so far from the truth. During this time in which God's people were under captivity by the Babylonians, a prophet by the name of Habakkuk was crying out to God. In the first two chapters of his book in the Old Testament, the prophet, he pours out his heart to God, and he's so honest in expressing his feelings and emotions. Look what it says here in Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 3. He says here, "Must I forever see these evil deeds? Why must I watch all this misery? Wherever I look, I see destruction and violence. I am surrounded by people who love to argue and fight." And in verse 13, it says, "But you are pure and cannot stand the sight of evil. Will you wink at their treachery? Should you be silent while the wicked swallow up people more righteous than they?" And then in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 1, this is what he says. He says, "I will climb up to my watchtower and stand at my guard post. There I will wait to see what the Lord says and how he will answer my complaint." And with these remarks from Habakkuk comes this question. So what must we do when we have lost heart in giving worship to our Father God? And we're always sighing. Well, we're going to look in the book of Habakkuk, chapter 3, and hopefully we all can learn from this prophet of what we need to do when it becomes difficult to worship our Lord. Well, look at number one here. It says we got to take the time to revere God. And look what it says here in Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 1 to 4. This is what it says. It says, "This prayer was sung by the prophet Habakkuk. I have heard all about you, Lord. I am filled with awe by your amazing works. In this time of our deep need, help us again as you did in years gone by. And in your anger, remember your mercy. See God moving across the deserts from Edom, the Holy One coming from Mount Paran. His brilliant splendor fills the heavens, and the earth is filled with his praise. His coming is as brilliant as the sunrise. Rays of light flash from his hands where his awesome power is hidden." You know, when we take the time to just praise God and be amazed of who he is and what he has done, I gotta tell you, it just changes the atmosphere around you. You know, it could have been that you're feeling so downcast, but suddenly when you start to praise God, just realizing how awesome he is, I gotta tell you, suddenly you're gonna start feeling so good. No matter how down you may have felt, when his presence comes, there is great joy. I want you to look what it says here in Romans chapter 1, verses 18 to 20. It says here, "But God shows his anger from heaven against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. They know the truth about God because he has made it obvious to them. For ever since the world was created, people have seen the earth and sky. And through everything God made, they can clearly see his invisible qualities, his eternal power, and his divine nature. So they have no excuse for not knowing God." You know, sometimes you can easily slip into the mode of worship when you simply stand in amazement and awe of God's creation. I got to tell you, you know, every now and then I will park my car at this beach park near my home. And as I just sit in my car, I just observe the beauty of God's handiwork. I look at the deep blue skies and the white puffy clouds as the sun shines radiantly and warmly over my head. And I am simply amazed. And, you know, and then I examine the vastness of the ocean, and I can't help but to think of God's great and awesome love. And I start thinking about what the Apostle Paul says in Ephesians chapter 3. He says in chapter 3, verses 18 to 19, "And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the Lord's holy people, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. And surely when I do look at the ocean, I see how wide, how deep it is. And really, I think about the love of my Lord Jesus Christ, realizing, yeah, I can compare the vastness of the ocean to the very love of my Lord Jesus Christ. Well, I want you to take a look at number two now. It says, take time to review what God has done in your life. Look what it says here in Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 5 to 15 now. Let me read it to you. It says here, pestilence marches before him. Plague follows close behind. When he stops, the earth shakes. When he looks, the nations tremble. He shatters the everlasting mountains and levels the eternal hills. He is the Eternal One. I see the people of Cushan in distress and the nation of Midian trembling in terror. Was it in anger, Lord, that you struck the rivers and parted the sea? Were you displeased with them? No, you are sending your chariots of salvation. You brandish your bow and your quiver of arrows. You split open the earth with flowing rivers. The mountains watched and trembled. Onward swept the raging waters. The mighty deep cried out, lifting his hands to the Lord. The sun and the moon stood still in the sky as your brilliant arrows flew and your glittering spear flashed. You marched across the land in anger and trampled the nations in your fury. You went out to rescue your chosen people, to save your anointed ones. You crushed the heads of the wicked and stripped their bones from head to toe. And with his own weapons, you destroyed the chief of those who rushed out like a whirlwind, thinking Israel would be easy prey. You trampled the sea with your horses, and the mighty waters piled high. You know, brothers and sisters, there are times in which we must look back in our past and review all the things that have happened in our lives. And, you know, there may have been good times and not so good times, but as we are reviewing our past, we must praise God for all that he has done for us. In remembering all that he's done, we are reminded that his mighty arm is always outstretched to us and is never too short to save us. And as we are remembering the things of the past, he may be telling you, hey, you got to forget some things that may be holding you back from moving forward with him. This is what it says in Isaiah chapter 43, verses 18 to 19. And this is the New Century Version. It says, the Lord says, forget what has happened before and do not think of the past. Look to the new thing I'm going to do. It is already happening. Don't you see it? I will make a road in the desert and rivers in the dry land. You know, I read a newspaper story about a woman named Jill Price who has this rare condition doctors called superior autobiographical memory. And, you know, here's the thing. Jill can recall in vivid detail every day of her life since age 14. And now she's in her mid-40s. You know, experts at the University of California, they studied her for 6 years to confirm her ability. And if you ever wish you had a better memory, you might want to reconsider. You know, Jill, she views it as a blessing and a curse. You know, she has warm memories that comfort her in difficult times, but there's also a dark side. You know, she recalls every bad decision, every insult, and every excruciating embarrassment, whether it was from her own mouth or others. You know, over the years, you know, Jill has said the memories have really eaten her up. You know, she feels paralyzed and assaulted by them. Peaceful sleep is very rare for her. And we all want to think of ourselves as basically good people. But, you know, we can believe that illusion only because we forget most of our past decisions and actions and thoughts. But what if we remembered them perfectly? I'm going to tell you, God, He forgets. You know, when we make mistakes, when we confess of these sins, He doesn't remember them. Look what it says here in Hebrews 10, verses 16 to 17. This is what it says. He says, "This is the covenant I will make with them after that time, says the Lord. I will put out my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds." And then he adds, "Their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more." And if you had made it right with God, and God, He's forgotten it, I'm going to tell you, so should you. Don't hang on to it anymore. The devil would want you to hang on to it so that you can proceed forward with the Lord. Sometimes God says, forget. Hey, you know what you do? You forget it. You have amnesia about it because God wants you to. Because He wants you to move forward with Him as He has a new plan laid out for you. Amen. Well, look at point number three now. It says, you must take the time to rest in God. I want you to look at Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 16. And this is what it says. It says here, "I trembled inside when I heard this. My lips quivered with fear. My legs gave way beneath me and I shook in terror. I will wait quietly for the coming day when disaster will strike the people who invade us." You know, while a missionary was serving in Paraguay, Argentina, you know, there was this Maca Indian named Rafael who came to sit on his porch. You know, the missionary states, "I was just eating and I went out to see what he wanted." And the man responded with this. He says in his language, "Ham hanek met." And again, I asked what I could do for him, but the answer was the same. "Ham hanek met." And I understood what he was saying, but not its significance. He was saying, "I don't want anything. I have just come near." You know, he says, "I later shared the incident with a local veteran missionary, and he explained that it was Raphael's way of honoring me. He really didn't want anything. He just wanted to sit on my porch. He found satisfaction and pleasure just being near me." And the Lord may be asking you, "What brings you here, my child?" Can we say ham, hanek met? You know, doesn't that reveal the heart of true worship when we just say, "Lord, I just want to be near you. I don't want anything. I just want to be with you, Papa God." Look what it says here in Hebrews 10, 22. It says here, "Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart." Wow. Okay, I want you to look at point number four now. It says here, take time to rejoice in God. And let's look at what it says here in Habakkuk chapter 3, verses 17 to 18. It says here, "Even though the fig trees have no blossoms and there are no grapes on the vines, even though the olive crop fails and the fields lie empty and barren, even though the flocks die in the fields and the cattle barns are empty, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my salvation." You know, brothers and sisters, if you are feeling distant from God, I'm just going to tell you straight up. It's not God, it's you. Or it could be me too, right? You know, there's this story about a husband and wife that were married for many, many years. And they were driving down the road behind a young couple in the car that was ahead of them. You know, the young couple had a car with front bench seats, you know, and this was back in the olden days, right, when they had those. And the girl was sitting right next to the young man who was driving and had her head on his shoulder. You know, the woman in the car behind, she just sighed and said to her husband, "Wow, do you remember how we used to be like that?" You know, her husband who was driving kind of looked across the front seat and said, "Hey, I didn't move. I'm still here." I'll tell you, God hasn't moved. He's still there. often it may be that we are feeling distant from Him because, guess what? We're not making the effort to draw close to Him. Yeah, it's about time we did. Huh? You know, it could be that, you know, we aren't humbling ourselves in worship. You know, maybe our offerings have become tokens and our lives are all about, guess who? Ourselves. You know, Jesus, He told the church of Ephesus in the book of Revelation, in chapter 2, verse 4, He says, "Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love." Simply put, you know what Jesus is saying here? You may have lost your joy in loving the Lord because, guess what? You love yourself more now. And that can happen. When we put all the attention upon ourselves, yeah, sometimes we may forget God. And suddenly He may, you know, seem like He's so far away, but you know, He's right there. He's waiting for you to give your heart fully to Him once again. I want you to look at point number 5 now. It says here, rely on Him all of the time. And this is what it says here in Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 19. It says here, "The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes me as sure-footed as a deer, able to tread upon the heights." The very fact here, we got to understand that God is King and Lord and Master over our lives gives us assurance that He will always give us all the strength that we will ever need. And He will give you the strength to continue forward with Him mightily, powerfully. And it says there, He will make you sure-footed as a deer so that you can go high. You can keep on going because you're not going to lose your footing. Because guess what? God is the one that's helping you to proceed forward. You know, a deer is swift and sure-footed and will scamper up the hills and mountains to find safety and freedom, even on rocky paths and difficult ground. If you can trust in the Lord, yeah, He will get you to wherever your heart desires. You know, there's this Christian author. Her name is Hannah Hernard, and she wrote a literary piece called Hinds Feet on High Places, which describes the Christian life. It is about a young woman, her name is Much Afraid, and her journey away from her fearing family into the high places of the Great Shepherd, guided by her two companions. You know what her two companions' names are? Sorrow and suffering. You know, have you made it to the high places? Well, I'm going to tell you, you probably got there because, guess what? Sorrow and suffering was with you. And you know, yeah, they may be accompanying you, but with God, we can rise above our circumstances. Amen? Well, you know, what we learned in chapter 1, right, as we read Habakkuk, he was feeling really low. In chapter 2, he climbs on the watchtower to wait for God's answer. And in chapter 3, guess what? He's walking on the heights. He has steadily progressed on an upward arc towards God. Well, let me ask you, are you ready to move from pain to praise? You know, the way to progress is to revere, review, rest, rejoice, and rely. Did you know Habakkuk's name has a double meaning? You know, it can mean wrestling, but you know what? It can also mean embrace. And sometimes we gotta just stop wrestling already. We just gotta fall into God's embrace. And we can see in his book, right, that as he moved from fighting with God to faith in God, he moved from wrestling to what? To worship. Are you ready to do the same? Well, I want you to take a look at the bottom line verses now. But before we get to them, let me tell you about a woman named Joni Erickson Tada. I'm sure you heard of her before. You know, she was a woman who became a quadriplegic through a diving accident at the age of 17. She hadn't walked or known feeling in her legs for decades. And while attending a convention, the speaker closed his message with an appeal for everyone to kneel in prayer. You know, Mrs. Tada was the only one that was unable to perform this task. And although God knew her heart was kneeling, she began to cry because she wanted to physically kneel before her Lord. And through the tears of passion, she prayed, "Lord Jesus, I can't wait for the day when I will rise up on resurrected legs. The first thing I will then do is to drop on grateful, glorified knees and worship you." Wow, isn't that powerful? You know, kneeling is but one expression of worship and can, like any other act of worship, be nothing more than a meaningless act. Yet, when we kneel out of true reverence for God, we can experience a unique aspect of worship. Mrs. Tada desires to kneel, but can't. Many of us who are able to may not find the time to do so, or simply won't because maybe of our circumstances. You may say, "How can I worship God now? Look at the mess I'm in." But you know, God is not really so much concerned about the physical aspect of this gesture. It is more of the spiritual act of your soul humbling down before our Lord God. And this is what it says in Psalm 95, verse 6. It says here, "Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our God, our Maker." Yes, it's important that we should kneel if you can. You know, why not? It's showing to God you're willing to go as low as you can before Him so that you can tell God, "You are way up here and I'm down here." But you know, in John 4, Jesus tells us what is of even of greater importance. Look what it says here in John chapter 4, verse 23. It says here, "Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks." I'm going to tell you, brothers and sisters, you will know it when you are worshiping in the Spirit. Well, how will you know? Well, this is what the prophet Zephaniah says in Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. Look what it says there. It says, "The Lord your God is with you, the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing." And I'm just tell you, brothers and sisters, when you truly are worshiping in the Spirit of God, God is going to rejoice over you. What does that mean? Well, you're going to know there's going to be such a huge smile. You may not see it, but you know it's there. God is smiling over you because He is so pleased with you. And I'm going to tell you, you know, troubles may come in our lives. Yeah, we could be sighing all the time. But yeah, you still can worship the Lord. And yeah, make it a point. Yeah, even though things aren't going your way, you're going to lift your hands in worship and say, "Lord, I'm so glad you are with me. I'm so glad that my life belongs to you." And when you can do this, I'm going to tell you, you're going to experience the fullness of God's presence. And you're going to know that He is so pleased because He knows your heart truly, fully belongs to Him. Amen? Well, praise God. Why don't we go ahead and let's bow our heads, let's bow our hearts, let's come before our Father in heaven. Let's pray. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for the message that was spoken today. And Father God, we truly desire to worship you at all times. It doesn't matter what our circumstance is. I know, Father God, as we continue to walk strong in this walk that we have with you, Lord, in this life that we know, you said, you promised that you will never leave us, you will never forsake us. Father, we know we are assured that you will always provide us with what we need, and that, Father, we're going to experience your goodness at all times because, Lord, you will never let us go. And regardless of the things that may be happening. Yes, we could be sighing all the time, but Father, as we turn that to worship and praise, we know, Father, the fullness of your love, your peace, and your joy will come. Father, we love you. We praise you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray all these things, and we say, amen. Well, thank you, brothers and sisters, for joining me today. I'll see you next week. And remember, give God all the glory. Amen.
I surrender to